morning was still young, but the red dirt foothills of the Guadalupes were already shimmering in the bright sunlight. A solitary rider, his black, flat-crowned hat tinged with the dust of many miles, drew rein at the edge of a dry wash.
Ho, ho. Easy, boy.
Bantam Audio Publishing presents Bowdrie Rides a Coyote Trail, a dramatization of the short story by Louis L'Amour.
What is it, big fella?
The sun glinted off the ranger's badge as he turned to scan the horizon in the direction from which he had come. Only a moment before, Chick Bowdrie had been dozing in the saddle, weary from the long miles behind. Then a sudden tensing of muscles of the hammerhead roan had brought him out of it. Pulling his hat lower over his eyes, he studied the terrain carefully, as one who knew his life might be at stake if he was not alert to danger. Nothing stirred, and yet something was definitely amiss. The ranger's legs, sensitive to every reaction of the horse he rode, had warned him. If he needed more warning, he had only to look at the roan's ears, tipped forward now, his attention riveted on a clump of trees up ahead. Whatever it was, Bowdrie could see nothing.
Come on. Attaboy.
Soft footing along the dusty trail, both the rider and his mount approached the grove of trees with wary attention. Bowdrie let his right hand drop back to loosen the thong that held his six-gun in place on the long rides. There was no change in expression on the dark, Apache-like face, except that the scar under his right cheekbone seemed to deepen, and his eyes grew more intent. They followed a well-ridden trail that ran along the base of a rocky ridge. Here and there, Bowdrie passed large boulders that had broken away from the crest and toppled down the slope. The strawberry roan, stepping daintily, advanced toward the trees.
Hold it, boy.
A few yards ahead lay the sprawled figure of a man. A dun-colored horse with four white stockings to the knees grazed nearby in the shadow of a tree. He was of good stock and flashy-looking for this part of the country.
Easy, there you are, boy.
The ranger sat his horse, his eyes sweeping the area with added urgency. He knew now that he would have to write a report on what he found here. Eventually, he might have to testify in court about the smallest detail of what he saw.
Partner, at least you were dead before you hit the ground.
The man was lying on his back with the sun in his eyes. No man could have taken a bullet where this one had without dying. From the size of the hole in the dead man's chest, the bullet had probably gone in from behind. Bowdrie turned in the saddle. There were any number of places where the killer might have laid an ambush. A large, brush-covered boulder some 50 yards to the west of where the dead man lay looked to be as likely a spot as any. The killer had taken no chances. Chick sat still on his horse, carefully looking at the body on the ground. The killer had been right to take no chances, as the man on the ground was no pilgrim, even in death. His was a good-looking face, but one showing grim strength and the seasoning by the wind and sun of long trails. He also wore two guns, and there were not many who did. Bowdrie walked his horse around the body, careful not to disturb any tracks. There were none, except for those of the dead man's horse. Bowdrie looked down at the man again, this time noting the chain loops hanging from the strap button of his spurs. He looked over at the dead man's horse. It wore an ornate Santa Barbara bit, a well-maintained saddle, and the stirrups were hooded with elaborate hand-tooled tapaderos.
California. You came a long way to get killed, mister.
Bowdrie walked over to the horse.
Steady, boy.
It shied a bit, but when he spoke, it hesitated, then reached for him with its nose, cautious but friendly.
Your rider must have been all right. You certainly haven't been abused.
He stroked and patted the horse, while his eyes quickly took in all of the details of the dead man's riding gear. The bedroll and saddlebags were covered with dust, which suggested that the man had been riding hard and camping little. The saddle itself was one of the finest pieces Bowdrie had ever seen, with fancy leather stitching and toolwork everywhere. The rawhide riata suspended from a loop near the pommel also attracted his attention.
80 or 85 feet, I'll bet. I've heard of ropes like that. California, you are a hand. Now, let's see what's in the bags.
Texas cowpunchers mostly use lariats of hair rope from 35 to 40 feet long, and they worked close to a steer before making a toss. It needed an artist to handle a rope like the one this man was carrying, although Bowdrie had heard of the California vaqueros who used ones this long. The saddlebags contained a change of clothing and a small amount of food. The ranger walked over to the dead man and went through his pockets. A penknife, a bandana, and a few coins. A small tin of throat lozenges. Bowdrie found nothing to indicate who the man was or where he was bound. Dust was heavy on the man's clothing. He showed evidence, as had the horse, of riding far and fast.
Riding to see somebody, I'd wager. Because from the look of you, you never ran from anybody.
Making a neat pack of the man's pocket belongings, Chick tucked them into a hip pocket. Then he took the dead man's guns and hung them from his saddle horn.
Well, California, or whatever your name was, the nearest town's Hacker, and it's too far to carry you.
He broke a dry branch off one of the trees that stood nearby and began to fashion a crude shovel.
I'll do what I can to keep the buzzards from getting you, though. And then there'll be coyotes. The four-legged kind, that is. Guess you've already run into the two-legged kind.
He found a shallow place where the ground was not too hard, dug it out a little with a stick, and laid the body neatly in the trough he had hollowed. Covering the rider's face with his vest, Chick scraped dirt over him, caved more from the bank above, then piled on juniper boughs and rocks. When he swung into the saddle again, he was leading the dun.
Come on, boy.
Starting away, he took a route that led past the brush-covered boulder. A minute and painstaking examination told him little. There was no doubt that this was the place where the gunman had hidden, but the ground was sandy around the boulder, and the footprints there, though deep, were indistinct.
Whoa.
He was about to leave when he saw the place where the killer's horse had been tethered. Something caught his eye, and he studied the side of the rock, scowling thoughtfully. The horse had waited for some time, judging by the hoof marks. It had evidently tried to scratch itself by driving his left stirrup hard against the rock. Bowdrie gathered several tiny fragments of wood from the rough surface. Dry and hard on one side, they were fresh and unweathered on the other. Carefully, he picked off several of the bits of wood, scarcely more than shreds, and put them in a cigarette paper. Hours later, when the shadows were beginning to reach over the little town of Hacker, Chick Bowdrie ambled the roan down the town's dusty main street toward the livery stable. The flashy dun horse trotted along behind. The dinner hour was not yet at hand, and the street was still busy with folks coming to town on an errand or for a bit of socializing after the day's work.
And she dumped him in the mud. Just like that.
Whoa. Oh.
That he never rode that horse again, I assure you. Excuse me just a minute, will you? Howdy, mister. Can I help you?
I'd like to stable my two horses. I'll put them up myself if you're busy.
Well, why, sure. You go right ahead. So like I was saying, that mare never let anyone ride
her. Bowdrie turned to take up the leads of the two horses. Across the street, in front of the saloon, he noticed a man sitting in a chair tipped back against the wall, who was watching his arrival with interest. Chick had only been a ranger for a short while, although his reputation was growing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.